I was thinking later on, you know, I do this kind of work since 1994, and the last couple of years it's getting better. But in the past, I've been called a liar and an idiot and a cheat and a fraud because what you say is completely, you know, BSB. Do you know BSB? Bullshit bingo? Right, that's one? Okay, so. And I want to share that one with you because the title was about, you know, doing agile versus being agile. And I want to tell you a little story about it, okay? First of all, I don't know. Have you ever heard the definition of perfect from Winston Churchill? I don't know if I quote him correctly, but his quote is like that: perfection is not a state, it's an ambition. And it, you know, to get there, you need to change all the time. So to get perfect means that you continue changing all the time. And somehow, and I'm very sorry to say, but somehow a lot of people, and I think a lot of people of you, are not so happy with change, especially people with gray hair and a beard. Those are the worst, you know, to change. So I want to tell a little bit about, you know, talk a little bit to you about that one. So first of all, can you just raise your hand if you are, you know, perceiving yourself as an agilist, working in some sort of way agile? Who is? Ah, okay, most people are. Now the good question is, what's agile? Let's do one step further. Why do we do this? Who wants to share? Why do we do agile? What's the point in this? Because we do it for a reason. Why do we do agile? Come on. It's early, I know. But why do we do agile? Sorry? Yeah, so there are a couple of things that we do. So the delivery, what else? Why are we doing agile?
To meet the requirements sooner.
Yeah, sooner, right? It starts. And in 1994, what I did, let me tell you a little in my background, and it also includes my story about change. First of all, I started my career. I was 15 years old. My mother had a history in the elderly care, and I knew for sure that I wanted to spend my professional life as a midwife delivering babies. And I was sitting as a 15-year-old with my mother at the table, you know, one day after high school, and I said, you know, this is what I want to do. And in the Netherlands, that was not the regular job for a man to choose. It was more for ladies. And she said, oh boy, if you want to do it, do it. Go for it. So I started at the age of 19 after high school. And after a year and a half, I thought, you know, it's time for new insights, and I don't think I want to do this for the rest of my life. So you stop, and in the Netherlands at the time, if you stopped your education, there was a bachelor program, then you had to go in the army for a tour of duty. So then I got into the army as a platoons commander in the infantry. And I remember after 6 months of education, my drill sergeant said to me, you're not going to make it out there. I said, oh, that's interesting. Why? He said, you're doing it wrong. So what's wrong? Wrong is what's not as it's written in the books. Ah, all right, that's interesting. So I got from my company commander after finishing my tour of duty, he said, if you want to, I can write you a letter of recommendation for the military academy. Do you want one? I said, no. And later on, you get those things that seduce you. Hey, that's the easy way in, right? So you can stay there and do the rest of your life, and you can go in if it's the easy way, if you get a recommendation letter. And I thought, maybe the easy way is not the best way. Today, if I talk about this kind of thinking, I always like to say that I'm the architect of my own life. And I always try to tell this to other people as well, because I don't like when people start complaining about the way it is. That's a very good idea, but it doesn't work for us. And then I ask back, how many times have you tried it? Have you done it? And the answer would be, no, we didn't try it, but it doesn't work for us. Here it comes. It doesn't match our culture, for example. And I thought, okay, how are you going to do? Because if we always keep on doing what we are doing, I think that's not the way. I'm not going to talk about Darwin, you know, the thing with survival of the fittest and the strong and smart, but it's the one most adaptive to change, right? So here it comes. And in 1994, I started in 1987 being, who of you knows what COBOL is? Who was a COBOL? Good. If you raise your hand, it says something about your age, just to let you know, okay? Yeah, okay. It happens. Nothing you can do about it, right? Yeah. So I started developing a COBOL, and some things stay, and some things change. And I remember that I started January 2, officially, education program for 3 months, you know, full-time program to become a COBOL developer. So mid-April something, I got out of this program, went to the office. I was working for Ernst & Young at the time. And this is no joke. The newspaper, the back, full-size ad on the backside of the newspaper, a tombstone. A tombstone that said literally, "Here lies Kobol, a true friend." And I thought, okay, that's cute. So I went to my boss. I said, "Can you explain to me a little bit about this?" He said, "Don't you worry. It will be there for a while." Well, the rest is history, obviously. In 1991, I made the switch to a consultancy firm. And they got me into those, big governmental projects. So tell me, here in the UK, I assume most of you are from the UK, how dynamic is working in the government? What does the silence mean? Okay. At least at that time, it was in the Netherlands not so dynamic. And it was, processed and very static. And I was part of a technical design team. And there was a work in there, and to make a long story very short, I was in a small room with two other people. We were the technical design team, and we all three got a document from the room next to us. As you can guess, there was the functional design team, and also three people. What's the characteristic of a team? What is the characteristic of a team? Just one. You work together, right? Have a shared objective, something like that. I talked to my roommates. I talked about everything, children and sports and the weekends and the whole, never about the work, because I would get from one of the functional designers a document, and they would get from the other functional designers their document. I would translate it into another document and hand it over to someone, as you can guess, down the hall in another room. And after a while, because what you do if you get into an organization, if you're new, you follow the people who have been there for a while, because they know the drill in the organization. This was the National Tax Agency in the Netherlands. But after a while, I thought, I'm here. I'm making a document out of another document, handing it over to someone who can read the first document. That's not adding value. I don't know how you want to spend your life, but this is not my way of doing. I want to go into my car. Car is too long to walk. It's an hour and 15 minutes drive. I want to go into my car at the end of the day with the feeling, hey, I did something. I delivered something. I cost tax money, but I delivered something for it. And I'm sorry, I couldn't say that. So that was, for me, an issue. One morning, 10:15, I took my car keys and I went to the office of the consultancy firm I worked for, Atos, these days. And I had the opportunity to speak to five of the six people from the management team. And I said, hey, listen, this is who I am, and that's what I'm not going to do anymore. And to be honest, I don't know what I want to do, because I don't know what's out there. And I thought, if they fire me, they fire me, and I'll find another solution. After all, I'm the architect of my own life, not someone else. And then I got into the world, because one of the managers gave me a call later on, and he said, hey, I have something for you. We have a pilot with the Royal Navy, and the pilot is about rapid application development. Who of you knows what rapid application development is? Thank you. When I ask these kind of questions, sometimes I see people doing this. And I think, what does that mean? Have you been there? Have you heard it? Did you read the book? But that's not a lot. Rapid application development was for me a change, because it was about business participation, workshops, change, and together with the team trying to do short deliveries. Maximum of 6 months was sort of the rule that we tried to do. And in 1997, this is why I sometimes write on Twitter and LinkedIn, I got in contact with the DSDM consortium here in the UK. Who knows the DSDM consortium? They will be very disappointed it's only you, I can tell you. Very. But anyway, they had this sort of shared thought, because they turned out to be the rapid application development user groups, bringing the lessons learned together in the DSDM manual, Dynamic Systems Development Method. And this is where, for me, it was like, if you do something and you like the book of James Martin, Rapid Application Development, it was awesome, but also gaps. So you fill up the gaps yourself. But then you meet other people who started with the same book. And obviously they met the same gaps, so they had the same lessons learned. So when you read their notes, it's like, hey, they look like my notes, because it's all common sense. And that's what I'd like to say. Rapid Application Development and agile, everything is structured common sense. DSDM, it's structured common sense. Let's not make it complicated. In the meanwhile, if you see where we are today, In 1994, we said, 6 months, that's no longer, if you term it in terms of projects or deliveries or MVPs. Today, I think it's even worse. One of the stories that I know, and it's all driven by technology as we know, one of the stories that I know from the Dutch market, for example, was the introduction of WhatsApp. Who of you is using WhatsApp? Most of people are in Northwestern Europe are using WhatsApp, right? What technology does, it offers a lot of opportunities. So what happened with WhatsApp, they came into the market, I think it was exactly 10 years ago in the autumn, in the 2008. And in almost 3 months, they wiped the big telcos in the Netherlands to bankruptcy, from the surface of the earth. Why? Very simple. It turned out that in 1994, telcos were making money with selling phone call minutes. And in 2004, they started making money with selling SMS messages, text messages, because the competition was getting harder. And then in 2008, WhatsApp came to the market, doing free text, off you go. 2014, I was in Brussels talking to a telco a couple of weeks ago, and I said this, in 1994, phone calls, 2004, it was text messages, 2014, internet access, 2024, you don't know. And it was a gentleman from the board, and he looked me in the eye and said, Ari, 2020, I have no clue. So what we have in terms of technology is not only that things are going faster, and that new technology make other stuff that we have obsolete, but what happens is it changes business models. So being able, and this is where we go, this is why we do Agile, being able to respond to that change is what makes you survive. Agile makes you future-proof. It's not because I'm deformed. It's not because I'm an evangelist. It's not about the word Agile, but it's about the corporate capability to be able to respond to change and to answer opportunities. That's what you do. So if you go Agile and you have, in a big company, only the IT department doing Agile, I have a major concern because it doesn't make your delivery to the market faster. And that's what it should be, right? So if you talk about what it is, it's about a corporate capability to deliver to the market. And I like to call that full delivery. So if you do a project or an MVP or even a two-week sprint and you deliver, at the end of that sprint, you go to production. And at least it's ready to go to production. Who of you at the end of a sprint delivers something that really goes, is ready to go to production or goes to production? Who does? Be proud. Yeah, because most people don't. Be proud. Most people don't. What they do is they do some sort of, this is doing Agile versus being Agile, is in this own little team that we have, we do all sort of Agile principles and things that we have the dailies and we have the plan board and we have a WIP limit and that kind of stuff. But if you only do it in your little team, don't do it in the big cohesion, you won't deliver faster to the market. And that's what Agile is all about, a corporate capability. If I go back to my last waterfall project in 1994, when I was, let's say, stuck in the middle, functional design, technical design, and developers, I recognized myself, it was three of us, what we did, the actual work that we did, was not only redundant, the three full-time equivalents that we were, you could take it out and add it to development, and you would just add three FTEs to development capacity, which makes you faster. But also, it takes about a lot of delay. Because what you have in a very, very often in traditional processes is a lot of remote and written communication. Remote and written communication has two major problems. Problem number one in remote and written communication is interpretations. Right now, you're listening to me, and you're making interpretations of my words, your own, right? What do you know about interpretations? They're wrong, yeah, they're wrong, right? You can be close, right? That's not the point. The point is, if someone sends you a document, like I got from my functional designer, and I start reading, what happens is I make interpretations, and interpretations are wrong. Now, what most people do is they get a document, even from someone in the room next, they get a document via email, right? They start reading, so they start making their interpretations. If you're lucky, they put on, in Word, track changes. You use it, track changes? I do use it a lot, right? And then you type your track changes in, and you send it back. But this person sends me a document. Before I read it, it's a couple of days, because I'm busy. I'm always busy. You too. So then I get your document and I do my track changes. After a couple of days, send it back. But you're busy too, right? So it takes a couple of days before. So I get a document, make interpretations, cost time. Then I put in extra information. I send it back. Reading that costs time. You make your own interpretation. So I stack mistake on mistake. And that's so this is why we, you know, deliver strange odd things. And also, if you keep the same kind of principle, if you don't do it integrated, the joke where people say, yeah, we do agile, we deliver every 2 weeks something you don't need because of the interpretations, right? So we have to get the interpretations out. And what is the most simple version to get interpretations out of the process and to solve them? What is the most simple way?
Talk directly with each other.
Yeah, sit at the table. Take time and talk. So the success factor in Agile is about, you know, the Agile rituals, dailies, retros, heartbeats, you know, that kind of thing. That's where the success lies. The quality, how you do them, and with whom, and the discipline, the fact that you're doing. Right? Because this is where you can clear out misunderstandings. This is where you can, you know, easily, you know, inform each other. This is where you make sure that you know where we are. Things about, if you work in an Agile way, that you understand that everything is about avoiding delay. That's the most important. I want to go to the market. I want to deliver. So I take out what costs a lot of time. Misunderstandings, that process of remote and written communication costs a lot of time. First, because of the interpretations. Second, because of the delay. So we're going to change that. And that's very complicated. Why is change so complicated? Because when I opened, I was talking about Mr. Churchill's, you know, thing about perfection being an ambition and continuously change. So we know that that is a success factor. You continuously change and improve. Why is this so important? And why are we hindering? Because most people are hindering change. What's the problem? Why are we hindering change as a human being? You know, any idea? Well, they say, I'm not a doctor or anything, but they say that in our head, there's the little reptile brain. And the little reptile brain is there, you know, if you're not religious, it's 650 million years old, and it's about survival. And it says to you, don't move. You're alive. If you move, you never know. All right? That's the message. So people resist, even myself. And the point is, you go back into that organization, there are seniors waiting for you because they work in the company for 10 years, and you come in and they tell you how it is. And they bring you into what they think is the, you know, the truth. And you know what the truth means in companies, means in cultures, means in families? They're called paradigms, a perception. A paradigm is a perception. Can I give you the most important paradigm shift to make? No, not the most important. One of the important paradigm shifts to make if you go from, you know, traditional work or just doing Agile to being Agile is that we go into other formats of documentation. There is a myth in Agile that we don't document. That's BSB, because we do document, but we document just enough and in another way. Because we know that if we write continuously Word documents to each other and we use that as communication, we know now that's causing delay and a lot of misunderstanding. So can't we find another way? So this is why we come into the area of information radiators. That plan board, if you work Agile, if you have your plan board, if you are an Agilist, if you understand Agile working, from 10, 15 meters, or yards if you like, from a distance, if you look at the plan board, if it's on the wall, a paper size one, you can see what's going on in the team without reading what's on there. You can see what's going on. This is the kind of information that radiates from a progress report. To be able to do that, you have to make sure that you do a, you know, proper burn down chart, that you have a good plan board with good slice stories and nice definition of done. There are some preconditions in the Agile way of working, but this is how it works. And I want to share a story with you. I was doing a transformation, and we do a transformation, obviously, at Humanity in an Agile way, right? And it's focusing on paradigm shifts. That's what we do. So I said in the beginning of the transformation to the two managing directors, listen, at the end of every transformation sprint, I want you to come to the transformation team space. We have information radiators with the transformation backlog, sprint backlog, and the burn down. And we are going to tell you and explain to you what we have done. After this, it takes maybe 15 minutes. We go to the teams, and you can see what happened over there. You can talk to your people. And then you have your progress report about the transformation. So after sprint one, you know, we have like 6-7 people coming into the team space, and it happens. And after the second sprint, again. And then the third sprint, I noticed all of a sudden that someone from the team, after this hour and a half, you can call it demo if you like, she would sit behind her desk, start typing on a desktop computer, and I thought, what's going on here? And that took a couple of hours, every 2 weeks. You know what she did? She was making a progress report in Word. And this is what a paradigm does. A paradigm does that you think this is the way it is. Okay, you did your progress, but I need in the old format. It means change. And this is an important thing to understand. What paradigms do, ladies and gentlemen, is they define your reflexes under stress. So what happens if you do something for the first time? What happens? Can go wrong, right? Or at least not superb, right? Because you are learning. We can go into a 2-day masterclass on working agile, but it doesn't make you the perfect agile person, right? But what we do, especially gray men, you know, with a beard over 50, like me. No, yeah, they look like maybe like me. What happens is you do something for the first time, you go into agile working, and things are not as you like them to be. You expect a certain amount of success, it's not coming in, so you try to improve, and then I say, oh, it doesn't work. Yeah, so people step back into the old riches. Ah, see, it doesn't work. Yes, it does work, but you have to learn. Right? So also in the paradigm shift is you can't do it perfectly in one go. That means learning and improvement. And when we wrote the Agile Manifesto, and I can only speak for myself, you know, I started working differently in 1994. Very consciously. I don't know about the others, but you know, the manifesto was written in 2001. And when we were said, okay, now the way we work in the traditional way is having a lot of problems, like delays, like misunderstandings, unhappy clients, delivering the wrong stuff, going over budget, going over time. And these days, it becomes more important. Now it's 2018, it's becoming more important even to deliver on time, because if you deliver late, I always say, no problem, the competition will be on time. That's what happens, right? Because there's so much competition. So when we wrote the manifesto, can I have the camera on the flip chart, please? Yeah, there we are. So this is, in my opinion, what happened when we wrote the manifesto, right? All of us, 17 of us, were working very consciously in a different way, because we had something that we wanted to improve. And for me, I couldn't understand the level of redundant work in the way we worked, but also just simply having a happy client. If you work and you deliver, and at the end you have a client that says, hey, I'm happy, thank you very much, that's such a dramatic change. So I was doing what I call full delivery. So large groups, 20 people, 30 people. I think the largest project team I had was like 85 people. Right. Then we have people that were working on the teams, like we know the Agile teams, like up to 9 max, 5, 6, 7 most of the time. And we have, you know, people that say, hey, how do we do it on the individual level or on the pair level? And this is where the focus, my focus was here, because I didn't recognize a small team. I want to deliver, you know. These days, I'm going to talk about the corporate capability. It's about doing it all together. At this time, this is, you know, the second half of the 90s. It was, I get a group of people, I split them up in, you know, parallel teams. They need to have cohesion, and then together we have to deliver one product or one service. Right? That was the focus. But that product needed to have for my client a lot of value, and being on time and therefore working efficient was for me also a very, very important one. And we had the quality. And if I'm very honest, you know, software products and services are not known for their, you know, awesome quality. The bugs are there all the time, I think still. But for me, this was my focus. And when we wrote the manifesto, I think if you look through you know, the 17 of us when we were there, for example, the Kent and Ward from Extreme Programming, that is on the individual level where you generate your with pairing and refactoring and test-driven development, where you generate a whole lot of quality, which is, I think, a winner. I spend my times very often on airports, and sometimes I need to order stuff, right? So I go online, you Google what you want to have. From the first page, you select a web shop, you go there, you start ordering, filling the basket, and you want to pay. If filling the basket, searching, or doing my payment doesn't work, swipe. Next. You have one chance only, right? Otherwise, you lose your customer. So quality is important. If you look on the team level, you know, where you have your dailies and your plan board, where you don't have continuously all this, you know, sending documents up and down, it's, for example, a lot of Scrum helps you here. And at the time, DSDM, these days it's called the Agile Project Management Framework, was large group, and I'm, in my opinion, on value. Now, those are methods, Agile methods, but they have practices. And practices they share. For example, those three all have a daily. I think it's the daily stand-up, the daily scrum, and the daily achievement meeting, if I am correct with the names. That it's the same thing, but they have different names. So methods and practices. And what I see very often is that people go Agile working, but they use one method only. And that can be a choice, but you leave so many best practices from other people. You leave them, you know, on the side, and they most likely will help you. I think, for example, from Jim Highsmith, Adaptive was here. I think also from Alistair Coburn, I Can Position Crystal here. If you talk about Lean, if you talk about Kanban can also be used here, of course. SAFe, etc. Right. So for us, if you wanna be corporate agile, there's so many things that can help you. And what I see at the moment, if you go into organizations, they adopt one method, they are very dogmatic about it, and they deny other people's learnings. And this is how you can serve your team, your program team, your project team, your organization or your department the most. If you grasp from this what helps you most. You need to know, obviously, that's why we have agile coaches. This is about changing paradigms. This is about changing paradigms in how you collaborate, how you make decisions. You know, want to know another thing that's very, you know, a changing paradigm in my opinion? It's what I call requirements thinking versus value thinking. People get totally distressed if you want to change a requirement. You know, even in a sprint, people get stressed if you want to change a requirement. Like, okay, so you have new insight and you have a change of the requirement and now it's becoming more valuable. Why shouldn't we change it? What's the point here? I just can't get it. If you deliver more value, what's your problem? You're only hindering change. And that's my point, right? If you talk about, you know, change and improving, can we go back to the slide, please? If you want about change and improvement, this is coming in your, it has to come in your system. And this is why here on screen it says, you know, agile as a metabolism, doing it together with all your natural reflexes. And that means that you have to work on changing your paradigms. And changing your paradigms is not an easy thing. Changing your paradigms means that you need to support each other in the change and that you need to be open. That if you say to me, hey, Ari, I think you're stuck in an old paradigm, that I don't say, no, it's not true. But that we sit down and we talk. Explain me why. I saw a lot of people saying, I'm an agilist. If you ask me, you know, what's the most important characteristic of an agilist is being open to reflect yourself, how you can improve. Because one thing, you cannot change someone else. You can only change yourself. So if something has to improve, start with yourself. It doesn't mean that you blame yourself all the time, but you can see, okay, what can I do to make the difference? What can I do to help my team improve? And I just made a list here of a couple of paradigms that need to change if you go from traditional working. And for me, if you apply one agile method, whatever method it is, and you do that one only, then it's also that paradigm still to change. For me, it's very important that we understand that becoming agile means that you are open to being in a changing process all the time. It's not like we implement an agile method and now we're agile. No, agile, being agile means that you look for continuous improvement. Over the last couple of years, we've seen, you know, from the agile rituals in the teams, you see now the movement, you know, to the technique and the technology layer. This one here, the bottom one, you know what I want. What I learned in 1994, talking about the misunderstandings again and the interpretations. If you go into agile working and you choose a process where you do this, where you say, okay, here I have the team, and here I have the business, whatever the business is, and we put someone in between. And that's most of the time how we do it. You know what happens is that the business talks to this person, so we have now interpretations. Then the person talks to the team, so we have the second level of interpretations. There come questions back, third level of interpretations, and then it's adding and adding. So what you need to do, instead of doing like this, you need to do it like this. And this is where you have the team, from IT and the business, or you know, production and the business, together. But that means that the business, whoever wants the product, has to collaborate in the team to be part of it. And that's the point where you need to change another paradigm, because the business will say, hey, listen, you know, I'm very busy, right? So you know what I want. And I always say, no, I don't. And it's even worse. You don't even know what you want. Because these days, we have a complex situation, we have complex environments, so we have complex solutions. So we know that we upfront in detail, we cannot define any kind of solution. So what we need, part of the work in the sprints that we have is exploring and see what's the most valuable one. This is why we don't have a fixed list of requirements. This is why we have to get rid of requirements thinking and we have to go into the value thinking. So you set the value and then we see what we need. In the beginning, you make a backlog because, okay, this is what we think that helps us the most. I want to give you a metaphor that I bumped into 2.5 years ago in April. I was sailing with a team of 6 the North Sea. And I'm a lousy sailor, but I can do it. As long as I have people that tell me what to do, I'm okay. And I did the cooking, right? I like cooking, so I did the cooking. And then on deck, I just, if they tell me what to do, it's okay. So you leave Amsterdam, you know, you go to the North Sea, you go to the coast, Belgium, and then we cross to the south of England. And it was 11 at night. Got into the harbor, quick shower, 12 o'clock, we were all back, and the skipper had made a course to go to Normandy in France. And he said, well, this is how he started. He said, tonight at 8 o'clock, we will have dinner in Cherbourg Harbor in Normandy. So that was the value that he was looking for. And then he said, you know, set the course how to get there sailing. And if you're sailing, you have the wind, you have the tide, you have the current, right, to take in consideration. So he did this. And then you get this little course, you know, it's a very strange course on a map. But it worked, as long you have wind, right? That's very important. So I had the first watch from 2 to 6, I think, 2 to 5, with my friend Johan. And at 5, we got, you know, the new watch coming in. So you go to bed. 9 o'clock, you get on deck again. And what do you think? The wind dropped. No wind. And this is where value thinking comes in. Now, you can look at the map and say, hey, this is how we sail, right? Because this is what the requirements list originally was. But the situation changed. And if you want to have still the value, dinner at 8 o'clock, a shower, you need to do something about it. And you can be in the middle of the sea and send out a request for change to the change advisory board. And I think it doesn't work. Because by the time you get answer back, you're in Norway, more or less, I assume. Nothing against Norway, but if you want to get to Normandy for your dinner at 8 o'clock in the harbor, you're not going to get there, right? So this is how it is. And then you need to say, okay, I have a team of 6 who knows what to do. As a team, they know how to get there, and they know how to respond to that change. You know what we did? We lowered the sail and we put on the engine. But we had dinner at 8, right? It worked. So can I back to the slide, please? So this thing of continuously changing, I always say if you look at the average company, people have a bachelor degree, have a master degree, let them do their job. There's a video from Daniel Pink on YouTube. It's a management quote that he says, you want to do something interesting, let me get out of your way. Because it's only hindering the team in delivery. And that's what we need these days. So there are a lot of things to do and to change. And I think here, another one is very important. What we see, there was an organization in the Netherlands, they were so proud of implementing Agile. They implemented Agile without changing the organization. Are you awake? Okay. Or are you in shock, for the quote? Also an option, of course. You know, if you want to be Agile, it's a change. You have to do something for it, right? And changing paradigms is something that's not so easy. Another metaphor. Let's say you play football, right? Green field, white lines, net, ball. Simple stuff, right? It's Friday, 5 o'clock, we leave the office. And I'll say, okay, listen. Monday morning, 9, if you come into the office, we're going to play volleyball. But if I keep that field 100 meters by 50 meters and I have two goals and a ball in the middle, people will keep on playing football and not volleyball, right? So if you change the paradigms, if you want to work agile, you have to start working on that. Your change process has to focus corporate on changing paradigms. Decision-making process, documentation standards, you know, collaboration between people, delivery cycles, technology using you, architecture facilitating that kind of delivery, because sometimes architecture doesn't. So the first thing that you do is, I like to look into an organization, because if you ask me, Ari, can you make me run the marathon in April next year? You know, can you do a training and coaching program for that, you know, for my transformation? Then the honest answer is, I don't know. Because I don't know how fit you are. And there's a complete change between how fit you are, if you want to become a marathon runner, or if you want to become someone who does a triathlon, or someone who does 10 kilometers swimming, or you want to be a ping pong player. It's different, right? So first of all, I need to know who you are, how fit you are as an organization, how agile ready you are, and where do you want to go? Is it time to market? A client of mine in Central Europe said to me, software delivery, he said, Ari, we have so many bugs, the number of bugs because of this agile transformation has to go down by at least 50% because we have so many incidents. So if you look at this one here, can I have the flip chart for a moment? That means in that transformation on his teams, there was a lot of extreme programming in there because that was so much improving the quality of the software code. I had another client in Germany, and he said to me, Ari, I'm a tech company, and Agile is for me about efficiency. So if I am able to implement Agile, to transform to Agile in a good way, I will save a lot of time. That time I will use for innovation because I'm a tech company, innovation is my lifeline. Two total different end objectives for an agile transformation. Two total different end objectives that have an impact on, okay, if we are going to help you as agile coaches in transforming to agile, on what kind of agile that it is for you in that situation. There is not one way. It depends on where you are and it depends on where you want to go. So if you talk about efficiency, you know, things like Kanban and Lean and a lot of Scrum in there, of course. Etc. If you talk about delivery of new products and services to the market, that include legal stuff, that include marketing, education, communication, training, you do full delivery, you go into agile project management, that kind of stuff. So there's a whole lot. Can I get back to the slides, please? That kind of change is something that really has, first of all, going back to why we do agile, we do it for to get a corporate capability. So you assemble teams that have all stakeholders together. Now the question is, who is a stakeholder? Who is a stakeholder in a team? If a team makes a new product, a new service, who is a stakeholder? Every department, every entity in an organization that can stop the team by not accepting. You know what it means? Not accepting. So it can be the business, because they accept functionality, but it can be the legal department, because they have to check if it's all totally according to the law. Then we have the marketing department, and they have to deliver as well, otherwise I can't go to the market. They have maybe education and training. So the point is, if you go, where we did in the past something like this, where you have the waterfall, and for example, analysis and functional design and technical design and development. Then you had something like a test and QA and user acceptance and pre-ops and ops, etc. What you do is you take in this two-week sprint, I prefer to work in 2 weeks. You take all those people that have here an acceptance authority into that process from day one here. One of the big mistakes that we do is that at the end of a sprint, we have a demo, and we perceive the demo as an acceptance test. You know what happens if you ask people, do you accept this? You know what can happen? Yeah, exactly. They might say no. Just an idea. You know what happens if they say no? You have a delay. We do Agile to avoid delay. We do Agile to be on time. You have to avoid delay. So what you need to do is, with all those people that have an authority in accepting something in the thing that you are making, to take them from the beginning and to build acceptance in your sprint. So at the end, acceptance is a given fact. And I'm not the only one who's saying this. I'm very happy that I saw a publication from Mike Cohn, who is one of the other authors of the Agile Manifesto. I think it's in January, it will be like 2 years ago, on LinkedIn, a post from him about this. And now, if I do this, you know, if I have all those stakeholders on a regular basis together, and then at the end, because if you give here, you know, you just show what you have, and you give a little bit of feedback, so the team can adjust, little bit of feedback and adjust. By the time that I'm here, I'm okay. Mr. Reichenberger, Fast Feedback Pays Off. Book, very nice book, read it. So this is the thing that you want to achieve. This is where you want to go. That means that you're in a team, you don't have IT, just business and IT, just the phrase, business and IT. It scares me. You know, we do it all together. It's not us and them. It's a shared responsibility, because in the past, people from QA would tell the team if they did their work the right way. We are going to tell you that you did it wrong, because most of the time it was like that. Now, those people are participating in the team, and they are co-sharing the responsibility to make sure at the end of the sprint everything is according to the criteria that we have set. And that's a different point, because we want to avoid delay. Nothing else. Can I go back to the slides, please? So what you do is, you know, you grab your teams in the assessment. Where do you want to go? What is it that you want as your first outcome of an Agile transformation? Time to market. Quality. What is it that you want to save time? What is it? Tell me. From there on, we look at, okay, how are you working at the moment? Because being Agile is not about, am I in front of a board at 9 in the morning? But that's about, you know, how are we perceiving change? How are we perceiving a mandate and empowerment? How we're perceiving change, right? That's what on. Are you ready for that? And then we start working on a backlog of change. And the first in synchronizes that we align together on what kind of Agile we think helps you at this moment in time best. So you assemble a set of practices that help you best from the Agile umbrella, if you like, right? From there on, in synchronize, the teams go into training and very directive coaching. We are changing paradigms. If you don't go into directive coaching, what will happen is that people will stick to their old routines. They will do their old stuff. They will say, you know, I understand the other thing about the daily, but we do the daily only once a week. This is a quote. This is not a joke. This is a quote. Because people don't understand why we do it daily. Why do we do it daily? Any idea? Second table. Any idea? Why do we do it daily? Yeah. And no, it's even worse. It's who of you had children at high school? Mine are 22, 26, so, okay. Who of you have been at high school? Okay, that's, some people don't raise their hand. Now it's getting interesting, right? This is, they think if I raise my hand, I get a question. No, you don't. I'm a divorced father, right? So my boys were high school age, and at Thursday they would come to me, and then at Monday morning they would leave again. So Thursday evening, daddy would cook meal, sit at the table with the boys, we have dinner. So one moment in time I was thinking, hold on a second. Don't tell anyone, especially with my youngest one. I said, hey, how are you doing? It is January now, in May in the Netherlands. In May we have exams, high school exams. How are you doing? And so I'm okay. Well, as a father, you're happy, right? Your boy says he's okay, you're ready for his exam. But I thought in February, you never know. Let me check, right? So I said, hey, I'm cool. I'm okay, good. March, hey, Dad, we're okay. April, I forgot. Second week of May, panic. They call it the student syndrome. It's not the student syndrome. This is a human syndrome. If you get 5 days to do something and it is not working well on day two, you start struggling, but you do it yourself because you want to finish the job. What we do with the daily, just an example, what we do with the daily is that we make that window where you keep on struggling on yourself, because we all do it, just one working day, no more. That's why you do it, Because now we can, as a team, we can respond and we can make sure at the end of the sprint that we finish, right? Synchronize is about that, getting it into. So one of the success factors is discipline, quality and discipline in doing Agile. So in Synchronize is focusing, you know, you change the environment. Talking about football and volleyball, it's about changing the rules of the game. You were doing it like this, we are going to do it like that, period. 4 weeks, 2 times 2 weeks we do it, most of the time. After 4 weeks, people understand the rules on the game, but we didn't change the paradigms. So what you now do, if you take the metaphor of sports, about, you know, talking and practicing, now we're going to play the game. So in follow, we focus on the team performance. So our coaches are working with the team and the shared interaction and making sure that the delivery really gets well done. And how to do, because, you know, the teams have their own learnings, they have their retrospectives, they improve every team in its own way. So you focus on team and team delivery. And then, because we go from a silo-shaped individual in Agile working to the T-shaped individual who is multidisciplined in the way of working, then in the lead process, this is where our coaches take individual time with the team members and say, okay, what do you make, you know, need to make your next step? What is your ambition? Where do you want to go? Because you were in testing, but are you going to do also development? Are you going to do also analysis? What are you going to take in? And this is the kind of cycle, if you run it, it takes us a quarter, you know, 3 months to get through. And you have to understand that at that moment in time, teams are working Agile, teams are delivering Agile, but you can't expect the average individual or team within 3 months to change completely paradigms. One of the biggest problems in paradigms is, if you look at an organization is like this, and here we have teams working, you know, they do the Agile work, the workforce, right? Can I have the camera on the flip chart, please. But in the organization, we have those silos, right? And the silos have to change. The bureaucracy is in there. The HR is in there. But we also know that every silo has, you know, a manager, a responsible one. You know how I call this layer? I hope I don't offend anyone. You know how I call this? The permafrost. Because teams want to change bureaucracy. People are not willing to change. So teams bump in. And this is why here, and now you come to another success factor, you know, the top of the organization has to help to change, because it doesn't mean that you don't have ways of working together, but it's going to change. Very simple example. If you have teams, you know, Agile is moving away from individual tasking to team delivery. I don't care who does what, as long as the team delivers. If that is how it works, but you work with individual targets and individual bonuses, you ruin team delivery. So you change another paradigm. And I think where we were, you know, in the first, you know, 10 years ago, getting into the team rituals, technology is now coming in. And at the moment, we're going, okay, what do we do with the workforce? How are we going to do that? It's a different way of facilitating your people in their development. So if you want to work in an agile way, can I go back to the screen, please? To the slides, sorry. If you want to work in an agile way together, it means that you really have to change. You get only the benefits from Agile if you do it all together. Your corporate benefits, you can only get by doing it all together. That's the thing. That means changing as an organization. You have to get there. And someone said to me, oh, Ari, please don't do the butterfly thing. And I said, well, you know, I can also do a frog if you like. But it's going to change, right? It's not going to be the same. Because if you keep it the same, you have the old bureaucracy, the old delays, the old acceptance process, it's not going to work. You don't have to be there in one go. Perfection, ladies and gentlemen, is not a state. It's an ambition. And it's the same thing with Agile. It's not a state. It's an ambition. And it means continuously changing with everything that you know, with evolving technology, and on the lessons learned. And that's where you need to go. And if you talk about change, well, people might say, you know, it can be different, and we are so busy, you know, like we have the workforce is totally overloaded, and then you get this kind of pictures, and we don't. Change is an investment. And if you want to deliver faster, and this is how your organization looks like, you know, here on screen, it means from corporate perspective, you have to find a way to get this bridge empty, because if the bridge is empty, then the delivery process can speed up, and you can deliver faster. It means that you have to change as a corporate. Now, the good thing is, in my opinion, that a corporate is not much. A company is not much. It's, you know, it's based on the individual people. It's based on you. So if you want to talk about that change, and you say change is so difficult, it means that the people in your organization make this change difficult. So the only one hindering the change is you, I would say. Same thing with culture. People say, yeah, it doesn't match our culture. Culture is an empty word. It's filled up by people. The good news is, so we can change it, starting with you. And I think this is where I want to stop. Thank you very much.